Welcome to Spiritual Spectrum. My name is Terry Kruger, and I'll be your host for the next hour as we explore some of the new and emerging trends on the American contemporary religious scene. Today we're going to explore the fatherhood of God, and with me in the studio today are three guests, and I'm going to allow them to introduce themselves to you and explain just what their specific interest in our topic today is. Hal?
Thanks, Terry. My name is Hal Katzen, and I've been spiritually active in a conscious way, I guess, for about 10 years. I became a faithful person about 10 years ago when I started reading a book called the Urantia book. It's been a great source of inspiration. My main interest in the topic today, though, really is not too closely related to the book itself. My interest here really is to try to bring theology in an accessible way to people. Mm-hmm. There's been a long history, I think, of theology being relegated to the great minds, the great philosophers. It gets very complicated, and there's all kinds of ideology and cosmology and, you know,
Hoopla
and proofs going back and forth, and it seems so much of what's written and said is for so few people. And I think really God is a much simpler matter to address than all this, and I'd like to just contribute to hopefully less confusion in people's minds rather than more confusion through a more simplistic approach. And I tend to look at the way the world is around me to glean my ideas and thoughts as to how God is. I think that there is a plan here. It's set up in a certain way to help us.
Well, we're going to explore that today. And our next guest is Bill Sheeney.
No, Bill Scheeley.
Scheeley, I'm sorry.
Scheeley. I'm pastor at a local American Baptist church in Wheat Ridge, and I'm interested in this subject because the fatherhood of God is a traditional Christian subject, but in recent days the whole subject has, well, in some ways, been thrown into a state of flux. We have a lot of different attitudes that people have toward this very traditional subject, and I think it would be interesting to explore what the new thinking is.
Well, thank you. And Nidra?
Yes, my name's Nidra Dasi, and I'm a missionary with the Denver Hare Krishna Temple, ISKCON Temple, on Cherry Street. And since about 1975, I've taken up Krishna consciousness as a lifestyle. And this subject, fatherhood of God, is of interest to me and all the devotees at the temple, and I think to all people in general, because God is really the most important personality in our life, and I'd like to try to person, and then that way feel satisfied in my everyday living.
Thank you. I think we'll begin by picking up on your point that God is a person. And one of the overriding interests that I have about this topic is, why is it that do we think of God as a father and perhaps not a mother? Why, if he's a person, does he have to carry that male connotation? Anybody want to address that?
Sure, I'll start in with it, I guess. I think the quick answer is God doesn't have to be addressed as a father. But the important aspect to your question is it certainly we have a long human tradition of it, which is, of course, it's coming under attack in many ways for being sexist. The patriarchal structure of Judeo-Christian religion is increasingly being asked to restructure itself in new ways, so women can be priests or rabbis, and as well, not just I think in Judeo-Christian religions, but in many religions. In fact, probably most of the religions of the world, they get around to patriarchal structures and theologies at one point or another. My feeling on it really is that we've been using the right word for all the wrong reasons, quite simply. And I think that there are good reasons and good ways to use the word Father for God in a way which is, which the word is liberated from its gender connotation. And
how do you go about that? How do you liberate it from that connotation in the minds of people?
Well, I'll tell you how I do it, and I'll try and encapsulate it. I've thought a lot on the subject, and it was a great source of consternation to me when I first started reading the Urantia book and read about the fatherhood of God, and there was no explanation. Why the fatherhood, I wondered, and in my mind, I kept using the word parent because I wasn't comfortable mm-hmm. with fatherhood. And one day, after a while, I had read for a while, and I decided, well, I will use the word father, even though I don't quite understand why. And it was several months after that that I got a philosophic understanding of it that made me very comfortable. That understanding is based upon the idea that God is a creative and volitional being. God's volition, his free will, and his creative aspects are not somehow undermined by him being a perfect and infinite being. These are not irreconcilable aspects of God, to be creative and to be perfect. What I came to understand was that volition was really the key issue. And again, I look to the way life is on this planet. If a woman is a mother, she knows she's a mother. There's no choice there. The biology is set up that way. If a father is a father, he may or may not know it. And it's just that simple. The biology is not tying a man down in such a way that he would absolutely know whether or not he's a father. And so choice is very important. A man chooses to be a father in a way that a mother does not choose to be a mother. This is not that men have more free will than women. It's not that at all. I mean, we all have limitations on what we can choose to do, given, you know, if we pick up both feet, we end up on the floor. And so what I came to understand is that I could use the word father for God in a way which I understood to be an aspect of his volition, of his choice. And in this way, the word was liberated from anything having to do with our cultural or sociological associations of masculinity and femininity and what it means to be a man and what it means to be a woman. Life is such that men have to choose to be fathers. And I want to glorify the creative free will of God. I think that's real important. I love it. I'm not relating to God as some machine who's restricted it to just do things perfectly by God. There's creativity on all of our parts, and that stems from God, and I want to glorify that. Mm. And so I want a word for God that has that, and I've got one now.
Bill, do you see God as accepting his role as a father by choice?
Yes, I think whatever God does, by and large, would be by choice. I agree with Hal that basically we are stuck with some images from just the tradition of the human race. Basically, men started out being, they were bigger for one thing, most of the time, and so they were more powerful, and it became a very chauvinistic world, so that the ancient Jews thought of God as a father, because a man might love his mother, but yet the mothers, the women, could be divorced with a snap of the fingers almost, and were considered second-class citizens. So I think historically the power people were men, and although we find some exceptions to that in the Old Testament and in the New Testament too, we find very, very outstanding great women. But by and large, as it is now, it was a man's world. But I think that today many people are starting to question that. I think that it's interesting to note that Jesus, at the very time that he composed the prayer Our Father, at the very time, historically, within a matter of days or months or whatever, within that same time frame, he was also doing what he could to liberate women, in the sense of his attitude toward the woman of Samaria and so forth. And Jesus himself at one point said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, if only I could have taken you like a, what was it, some sort of a bird, a hen, and tucked you under my wings." Now that is a very, very, in chauvinistic terms, a very feminine sort of image. So we see this androgynous sort of attitude on the part of Jesus. I think in Jesus we find a beautiful example of the combination of what we traditionally call both the feminine and the masculine qualities. And so when we turn to God, then it seems to me we have to say that God, since God is a spirit and not simply a human being the way we think of as personality being structured within bodies and with specific kinds of sexuality, then therefore God has to be something of a combination of all of those qualities.
Nidra, let's hear from you now. What do you think?
One reason that traditionally we find God explained as the Father is because of Scripture. And I wanted to read one verse from Bhagavad Gita just to give that example. It's explaining, "It should be understood that all species of life are made possible by birth in this material nature, and that I am the seed-giving Father." In this verse, it is clearly explained that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, is the original Father of all living entities. But at the same time, in the Vedic literatures, it's explained that God is a complete personality, which means he would not only have masculine attributes, but also the feminine. And not only the attributes, but he manifests his feminine potency in a spiritual personality that you would call maybe the Divine Mother, the Mother of the Universe, and we call her the Mother of Devotion, the Mother of Love and Compassion, Radharani. So in Vedic tradition, you'll find descriptions of the spiritual world where God is manifesting himself in both a spiritual form as Krishna, or the supreme male attractive personality, and then as Radharani, the supreme female personality. So in Vedic tradition, you find that is there throughout the histories.
That's interesting. It seems like we're building a case here that historically there has always been recognition of the feminine side of God the Father, but it gets downplayed through the traditional religions, maybe. Hal, you mentioned that you're a reader of the Urantia book. Is there a counterpart feminine side of this concept that you mentioned of the fatherhood of God there?
Yes and no, I would have to be the answer to the question, I guess. the reason I have trouble answering the question to begin with is because I'm very much in agreement with what's been said so far, that God is genderful, not gender-specific or genderless. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As a genderful being, my understanding of God from the Urantia book, even though the word father is used, is not that God is somehow more like what would be considered a father in any sort of, as I would say, social or cultural terms of masculinity or femininity. Words to me are very important, especially when we're talking about something as important as God, which much structures our relationship to our own lives and the world around us and other people's lives. So to come back to your question about what's in the Urantia book, yeah, there are areas in which the Urantia book talks about God as a mother, and it some parts have to do in the explanation of Trinity and things like this. But I think it's always important to remember that when we're talking about the largest sense of God, the most important, most valuable qualities and aspects of God, I think they center on God being personal, parental, and volitional.
But is he parental as the father and mother together?
Well, this is a good question. Yes, God is parental as a father and a mother, as we understand, you know, father and mother in the best human senses of what a father and a mother may provide for a child. That's true, yes. The word father, I don't believe, is used in the book to say that God is more like that father than that mother image that we have of our own parents on this world. I really believe it has to do with volition. So it's important at times to bring out how God is perhaps more like our masculine concept of, you know, men and something, more like the feminine. Mm-hmm. We talked about the hen, you know, bringing in the brood. We talk about God in a lot of different ways, and it's great. It's a big topic, and it's good to break it down sometimes.
But it does sound like we're kind of all in accord that we're talking about a relationship to God that incorporates all aspects that we can learn about the mother, son-daughter relationship, or the father-child relationship, that he embodies all of those things. Is that the way that you feel about that?
Yes, I think so. That basically, I try, and sometimes in my prayers or various things that I will do in worship, try to use the word parent whenever I can. And I find that in some ways this is an unhappy compromise for most people, because I have some feminist in my congregation who would really like me to use the word mother far more than I do. And then, of course, those who have grown up always listening to the word father, then they sure don't want me to use the word mother, but parent really doesn't necessarily make them any happier either, I don't think. But it seems to me that either, if we take just a very narrow, strict concept of either the word mother or father, then at least from my standpoint, we're going to run into heresy somewhere, because God is not, as Hal said, in terms of the gender, I think you're saying, you know, wasn't the, you know, we can't speak of God as being gender specific, wasn't that your phrase?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so if God is not gender specific, then God is in a whole different class, a whole different realm from what we are thinking of with our limited kind of knowledge. We just have to recognize that whatever term we use, we're speaking anthropomorphically, or we are speaking with parables and images and so forth.
But does that make it harder for people who are struggling to understand God in general, whether they're thinking of him as a father or a mother, does that intangible quality make it more difficult for them to relate to him as a personal being? If they don't know which, should I address him as a father or should I address him as a mother?
You know, one thing that's interesting is that in the oldest histories written in the world, originally in India, called Srimad Bhagavatam and these Vedic histories, it explains how even God manifested in a feminine form to attract so many personalities to him because of his femininity. He was called Mohini Murti. And he was the most beautiful female personality that one could ever see. And he actually manifested that personality in a spiritual form that could be seen. And then also, the histories go on to explain the nature of relationship with God in the spiritual world, how he allows his devotees to have all relationships with him, that some devotees relate to him in a parental sense, where they take care of him and they act as a father and mother, because that is their spiritual desire and way that they want to serve God. And then others are given the opportunity to serve him as a friend, and others as like a sort of like a wife or a beloved, and others as servants. So in the Vedic tradition, you see that all relationships can be there in your loving exchange with God, however you feel towards him. It could be any of those relationships. And he will satisfy your desire and how you want to relate with him.
Nidra has brought up another interesting part of that relationship, I think, that we have with God the Father, and that's serving God the Father. How do we serve? How do you serve God the Father, Hal?
I like the turn that the conversation is taking a lot, because we're really getting into, I think, what's a primary purpose in all this, which is the nurturing and fostering of loving relationships. And it's been brought up in several different ways. We had Bill bringing up how some people do not hear well and are not inspired to love by words that have to them masculine connotations. Nidra brought up how love is manifest in quite a variety of ways as servant, as parent, as beloved. And this is really, I think, what's so important to keep a focus on the purpose. All of this should be bringing out love in people. The best motives and intentions and desires, if they're put out in a way that someone else cannot be responsive to for whatever reasons, it's going to be lost. This is a hard lesson to learn. I know it has been for me in my life. There's nothing wrong with making it go down easy, is what I'm learning more and more. That nurture the love where it is, as it wants to be manifest in all people, without prejudice. As long as love is nurtured in a way that is not bound with prejudice, I think a lot of good will be done. Eventually, it will all come around to the highest of forms of love. The journey is a wonderful journey, and it should be nurtured in all the creative and varied ways that there are people on the planet. So I'm very happy to see that we've come around to this. We can talk a lot about words and thoughts and ideas, and I'm all for it, because I really believe that a good mental structure, it helps it go down easy. You know, it's hard to reconcile the infinite with the finite, the time, space with the eternal. And when we talk about words for God and understandings, I think that's real good, because it makes it easier to love. It helps the mind, puts the mind at ease. But love really is the purpose in all this, and so I'm real happy to hear it expressed in so many ways. That sure, we can talk about words and ideas, but
well,
what's it going to do?
Traditionally, I guess most religions stress the idea that we're supposed to love one another, And I guess the fatherhood of God kind of presupposes the brotherhood of mankind. And Bill, you come from a fairly mainstream Christian tradition, and that's probably a concept that you use to describe that relationship.
Yes, American Baptists are one of the mainstream, old-fashioned, we're saying nowadays, traditions in this country. Yes, we speak about the brotherhood of man a great deal. I don't know that we've ever taken it really with as much seriousness, though, as we really ought to. I've been reading recently a book by a man who can't think of his name now, but it took him 17 years to write the book, entitled The Seven Mysteries of Life. And in this book, he did all kinds of research on both spiritual and physiological and biological kinds of things. He deals with the whole universe, everything from microorganisms out to far out space and so forth. And one of the things that he deals with in that book is the attitude that, well, the belief, he believes is a scientific fact, that none of us can be any further related from one another than a 50th cousin. And we're more likely to be something like a 30th cousin.
Really?
And he does this from a mathematical principle that if you think of two parents, four grandparents, eight great-grandparents, 16, and so on and so forth, that after a while you get back to the year 700, where all of those various people had to have converged. I mean, even as short a time back as 700 years ago. So that he says that all of us, in fact, those of us who are Anglos simply have to have some Oriental blood in us and have to have some African blood in us. And we all of us, regardless of what our race is, no matter what we look like, because of the gene pool and so forth, regardless of how fair we are, how dark we are, we all have some of the relationship, actual and real and biological, with everyone else on the face of the earth. Now, I find it interesting that from a scientific point of view, he's able to bring that in and tell us in a very specific way that which we as Christians have been trying to tell one another for a long, long time. But you say, I don't think we've really taken it seriously.
Right.
We haven't really thought to ourselves, hey, cousin, you know, you may be, probably people within range here are not any more than, I think you said, a fifth or sixth cousin. I mean, we have to have common ancestors, so we are a part of this brotherhood or sisterhood or whatever of man, and we just have to recognize that there is that commonality that we have to each other. And I just really wish that message could get across to the people that are so terribly, terribly hung up on all of the business of having some kind of purity of race. And I wonder how they can be so sure that that there wasn't some sort of thing going on somewhere in their history that someone may not have even known about.
Well, that kind of thoughtless behavior that they act out a lot of times, which causes so much strife, really reflects the fact that they obviously haven't even thought of it at all.
No.
Where, even if they don't even think of it in a religious context, where did we all come from? Mm-hmm. Yeah. If we suppose that there was a first man and a first woman, then we have to be related by virtue of the fact that there's no other source. So, right. Nidra, does the Gita say anything specific about how we all came to be here?
Actually, we're all related because we're all spirit-soul, and we're all part of God. We're all spiritually equal. There's no lack of relationship amongst any soul in any universe, because of that original father and the original family. So there's no, on the spiritual platform, there's no distance at all. And even in terms of the bodily platform, we believe in reincarnation, so maybe all of us were all in the same family in a previous life.
Hi, Dad.
Hi, son.
Well, what I hear a little bit is really an insider position on all of this. It's all these things I think are very comforting in ways to those of us who already, you know, feel that. Because I see love is outgoing and encompassing. Good thing, you know, everyone can get some, right? I'm always concerned for those who are not feeling a brotherhood. So I tend to really shy away to, you know, from points of logic or doesn't it seem like it ought to be. Someone can just as easily say, well, maybe quite a number of human families got started at the beginning. What binds us to thinking, except our literature, that that there was one family? And again, you know, I have personal beliefs about how it got started, but it really doesn't matter to someone who doesn't share them.
Who doesn't realize
you know,
it at
so
all.
In respect to the audiences who don't share that, I think it's important for us to, you know, take a look at what we have to communicate to them as well. There's something about love that I think is infectious, and it doesn't need logical proof, you know. And I think often people tend to shy away from even the idea of, well, you know, we must all be brothers because of the numbers or because there had to be a first family. And so I really try to put it on the foundation of love itself. It's interesting to me that today there's a lot of talk of brotherhood without fatherhood. And I think it's sort of a testimony to how much love there really is in people and how hard people really are trying to bring love into the world. And the reason I say this is because when people talk about the brotherhood of man, we're all family, without talking about the fatherhood of God or the parenthood of God, it's an incredible attack upon the logical mind. I don't think most people consider it really, and for good reason, because the love that's trying to be nourished is much more important. But I'd make a prediction that eventually people become disenchanted with that for the simple reason that the concept of children without parents is wholly unreal. There is no example of it.
Oh, there's examples of it all over the United States.
Well,
children with no parents,
yeah,
orphans.
Orphans. But
of course they did have a parent.
They did
at one
have
time.
A parent. And the thought that any of us came into the world without a couple of parents
is
to get
absurd.
Is absurd. The thought of an apple without a tree, you know, we can think about it, but life doesn't present itself that way. And at some level, eventually, it's got to get back to, if you really want to believe in the brotherhood of man, the leap of faith, which is really a love leap, is going to come into play. And people are take it, you know, in various steps and in all kinds of different ways. And I think that the brotherhood is just... the brotherhood concept without a fatherhood concept is just one of the ways people are, you know, starting to take leaps and really trying to do it. But eventually it's got to come around to something that's going to satisfy the mind too, and that is, how are we going to be all brothers? We ain't got any
parents. How are we going to do this? How are we going to do this?
Right.
We've kind of defined the relationship now,
yeah. And
now we're at the verge of, I think, discussing what is it we do now to reach somebody who doesn't have an awareness of that fatherhood. Maybe they do feel that love and the need to reach out to mankind as a planet. There's a lot of ecological awareness that seems to be burgeoning today because of how bad we've treated our planet. But how do we make that leap of love, that leap of faith, to recognize? It would seem logical to think that if we're all children, we must have a parent. What do you do in your personal lives to reach out and share that awareness with people? Go ahead, Nidra. You brought the Gita for me today, so you're attempting some things.
Well, that is One of our ways of reaching out is distributing our books and distributing spiritual food, vegetarian food that's offered to God. And that's always a loving exchange. People like to get together, families like to get together and have a Christmas feast or something like that. So in that way, people can share something that's offered to God with love and devotion. So we see that all our life should be meant in service and offering to God in practical activity. Everything we should be doing is done in that consciousness that we should glorify God in congregation with others. And in this way, we feel that brotherhood. And the whole aspect of fatherhood is such that as the children grow up, they don't always want to continue taking service from the father, but they want to render service to the father because they've become matured and they feel that now is time to reciprocate with the father, not just to take, but to give, and to take all one's words and talents and abilities and use that in the service of the Lord to raise one's children as God-conscious children, to offer the fruits of one's labor, to help establish God consciousness. And also we see the fatherhood of God relates to different habits, like we're vegetarians and we see all the creatures as God's sons and daughters. And so we also want to not inflict any unnecessary violence on them, and that helps to protect the environment in turn. So in all these ways we can serve God in practical activity.
Bill, something you said a moment ago really kind of caught my attention. You said that even though your mainstream religion has always had brotherhood as a concept, that you didn't feel that you gave it the proper emphasis. Do you feel like that's an important area now to help understand the fatherhood of God better?
Well, I wasn't trying to cast any stones on my denomination or on those of us as preachers. I was just thinking that that it just seemed as though at least I find that, well, I think that being a minister, I have a lot more privilege than a lot of people do. In other words, a lot of my time can be spent in reading and reflecting and thinking. I mean, I really have to be, as other ministers are, the theologian at large. I mean, I have to be, that's really my job, is to be thinking through
those things. You're the man behind the plow.
Well, I don't know about that. But at any rate, you know, it becomes necessary for me to be a thinking person and to be reflecting on those things. And maybe the better truth of all of that is not necessarily that we have failed so much in the concept of the brotherhood of man, as it is that there are so many things, so many concepts within our faith that we try to you know, communicate and so forth, that maybe people don't have the chance to. Most people, I think, don't have the chance that those of us as clergy have to really think about those things in a more deep kind of way. And I think that probably one of my occupational hazards is that we as clergy tend to be very judgmental of our parishioners or other Christians, and we say, you know, why can't they get on the ball, and why won't they do this and do that and do the other, and why doesn't this idea sink in? And so, you know, I find myself kind of, you know, devil's advocate to myself on this thinking, trying to be honest with the situation while at the same time, you know, pushing toward an attitude of brotherhood. I think basically it's just my thought that for our day and age, we simply, as a human race, don't have a heck of a lot of time to have the luxury of squabbling with one another. I just think that we have, you know, war has been a wonderful pastime for people. I mean, I think some general said it's a good thing that people don't enjoy war any more than they do, or some such thing. I mean, you know, the fact is people do enjoy war, and people do enjoy fighting. I know individuals that enjoy fighting. Sometimes I enjoy a good verbal scrap. So, you know, but I don't think we can continue that way. Somehow we've got to take serious the whole idea that people have to learn to cooperate somehow. We've got to somehow or other be prepared for another evolutionary leap. And I don't know what it is that caused the evolutionary leaps in the past, but I think we've simply got to be able to do that. And I think that thinking in terms of brotherhood and fatherhood, fatherhood of God, are really, or parenthood of God, are certainly a part of that leap we have to take forward.
Well, whatever that leap is, I imagine it's our children that are going to be responsible for it, or these generations that are coming up. And, you know, we've been talking about our relationship with God as His children, but how do we broach this topic with children? We're adults, hopefully, but we act like adults, but the children, how do we introduce this concept to our children to give them the understanding? Is it simply by being the mother and father in the family, or is there something more overt that we can do other than our just sending them to church and making sure they receive religious instruction? Is there some other dynamic at work here that we can bring them along to make that leap?
How I was speaking about being volitional, was that the word?
Yes.
Daniel, volitional of God. I think we also have to be volitional. I think that it's possible to live one's life kind of drifting along or taking things for granted and so forth. And I think, I read somewhere the other day that something about making decisions I remember now, the woman was saying, it was a nun who wrote a book, as a matter of fact, and she was saying, she has a book entitled 10 Fun Things to Do Before You Die. And among those things, she says, take a position. It doesn't mean that you have to be fighting people about everything all the time, but she said, take a position, take a stand. And I think that's what many of us don't want to do. We don't want to stick our neck out. We don't want to say, this is where I stand on an issue. And one does not have to be obnoxious about that. And when one can still have a great deal of respect for other people from where they stand, but I think we have to take a stand and be volitional and make our lives count by doing something rather than just drifting on and letting some, and then somehow or other feeling that as though we're victims.
Mm-hmm. Hal, you were going to say something?
Yeah, I'm real glad you brought up the aspect of children, because I think that's where we're going to see the changes in the world. Obviously, it's how the generations evolve through time that create the kind of world that we're going to live in. Raising children is very interesting, because there's some things you can do and there's some things you can't. And now, I don't have the benefit of speaking from the experience of a parent. I'm not one, but I have been a child. So I do know something about it. And that is that beliefs, we can share among each other. We can have common beliefs. But faith is always a personal experience. Faith is, as we were talking before, the love leap. And what does that mean, and how are children going to be affected by this? Well, I think that that emotions have a real purpose, and they basically fall into two categories in terms of telling us about ourselves and what's going on. I think there's emotions of fear and emotions of love. Take various manifestations. We give them different kinds of names, or happy or joyous or peaceful and all these, love, right? Or we're angry and we're jealous or we're vengeful, and these, I think, are essentially fear. We're afraid of something, Someone's gonna get more, someone's already got more, someone's gonna hurt me, or I better get mine while I can. And these are fear. And so the question then becomes, how do you nurture the love and, try to get away from the fear? Most people don't enjoy those emotions very much. They're part of human experience. They're educational. I'm not advocating denial, of who we are, but I am asking the question, how do we get to be more loving? And so I may look at the other side of the coin a bit. What gets in the way? what are the primary fears? And I think that they're twofold. One is death. What if we only go around once in life? Oh my God, better get it while I can. Or there's all kinds of fears associated with limitations on our time, limitations on our life. And how this gets played to children is real important. Mm-hmm. If children fear death, it's a big problem. They're going to have all the kinds of, you know, aggressiveness towards other people that is quite natural from having a fear about your life. The other great fear, I think a source of fear, is isolation. That is me, or there's my family, you are not my, you know, it's who's our family, okay? There's always a fear of people that you do not recognize mm-hmm. as commonly related to yourself. So as far as children are concerned, I think, again, the simplest approach is the best. Look at the primary fear motivations and foster ways in which a child can break out of these. And that's just a simple faith that God relates us, that we are all children of God, and that God will take care of our life beyond this one. And we're talking about this in many ways. People have different theological beliefs about it. But I would say this fundamental kind of faith belief about whether or not there is something to discuss, you know, some form of life beyond is really the key question. And children learn by the examples around them. And I think when we live a life of love and security because of our faith, this is what will bring children along to want to relate to everyone as family, to not be afraid of laying down this body, to not let this body get in the way of love, because it's the love is much more important, and children will respond to this. They're naturally loving creatures until they're conditioned and taught otherwise. Children like to help out, and they very much are into personifying. You know, the imaginary friend is, you know, so common. I think this is God's way of helping out a little bit. That's good. Foster, mm-hmm. you know.
Talk to someone.
There is an imaginary friend and maybe mm-hmm. even a real one there that you can talk to and be with. And the feeling the presence of God is...
I think you've really put your finger on something, though, too, Hal. And you pointed out, expanded on what Bill just said, that we are motivated. This nun who said, take a stand before you die, was really hopefully saying, take that stand in love instead of fear, because I think we see in the world that fear is definitely a motivator for people to take a stand, because we've got a lot of that going on in the world. But this teaching people to take the stand in a positive, loving way, we have to destroy taking a stand through fear. There's a lot of that going on.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of... people who may not, as Hal is, are not parents, and I would not want to discount the fact of influencing the world, whether you are a parent or not, or I would not want to think that we simply have to think about the younger generation. Very often it is older people who have the most influence in the world, wherever that happens to spin off at.
And definitely the most experience.
Yeah, well, I think of the two greatest influences on my life probably were my two grandmothers. Uh-huh. And if they had not been as supportive and toward me and loving toward me during my childhood as they were, I don't know where I'd be today. And so I sometimes think, you know, that it's grandmothers, nuns, and angels that hold the world up. So, you know, I think all of us can have a part in changing the world in some way. I wanted to say something else, too. This is about the fifth time I've been on this show. Uh-huh. And one of the things that I've noticed is that, the people that I've been with every time have been people of very different kinds of theological beliefs from my own, at least essentially some very great differences, I think. But I think it's important for us to recognize that one doesn't have to compromise his or her own beliefs
in order to validate and affirm other people. In other words, I think it's a two-legged sort of process, that one can validate and really support other people and affirm other people, while at the same time still holding very, very strongly to what one really believes in.
Yeah, it's a recognition of the unity that we share in the spirit rather than the uniformity, that the not seeking a uniformity in belief necessarily. That there are so many ways to reach that fatherhood understanding or the awareness of that relationship with God.
Well, in that way, I think that we actually live out the childhood or the brotherhood, sisterhood of people. And I think it's the living out of that that is going to really speak more to people than the words.
Well, speaking of living out, that's brings me to the question that I've been burning to ask all of you. Okay, I understand God is my father. I'm going to live my life that way. But what's it all for? Where am I going? Well, I mean, am I living forever? Do you all pretty much believe in life after death and that this relationship is going to continue to grow? Nidra?
The soul's eternal. The body may die at one point, may die 10 minutes or 10 years or whatever. Body's just temporary, but we're spirit soul, and the soul will go on. And whatever is the consciousness at death determines the next life. So for the children, it's very important the parents set a good example, a God-conscious family life. And then in their life, they develop a devotional attitude towards God. And then at the time of death, they can actually be remembering Him. And then that consciousness will bring them to God. If the consciousness is materialistic, then it brings us to that type of situation that we're actually desiring. So we believe that the soul's eternal, and we believe in reincarnation. And we've had so many lifetimes ourselves in these material universes. And the purpose of life is to develop pure love for God and to go back to Him and to solve the problems of life, birth, death, disease, and old age, and not to come back and repeat the same things over and over again in a materialistic consciousness, but to actually have pure love and devotion for the Supreme Lord and then for every living entity.
It's that going back that's got me excited today, I guess. Bill, you, as a traditional Christian philosophy, theology, they do talk about getting to heaven.
Yes. Yes, I think the ideas of heaven have changed through the years. And I think there's always been the thought that this is an affirmation of faith rather than affirmation of something that we can state with a sense of absolute knowing. But of course, the fact is that there are very few things, if anything, that we can ever state with absolute knowing. But I think that for most of us, if we're honest, as Christians, we do vacillate back and forth, sometimes having doubt, sometimes having belief. But and for me, I find that the vacillating back and forth gets less and less and goes more to a belief of a heaven, of some sort of an afterlife. And that's based really on the fact that I believe in a good and loving Mother, Father, God.
Well, we're going to take a short pause here for a moment. Well, hopefully we've had some viewers out there who we've stimulated with our discussion. And we're going to flash an address on the screen for you so that you can send your letters to Spiritual Spectrum. Our address here is 2351 Ogden Street, Denver, Colorado, 80205. And there's a phone number there, 861-1186. Give us a call and let us know what you think of our discussion today. If you're truly a child of God, then you've had some interest in our discussion. And we're going to wrap up our discussion today by, I'd like to ask each one of you to summarize any points that, first of all, you didn't get a chance to say, and second, how you're really going to carry this out into your life from this day forward. Hal, why don't you start?
Okay. I think I'd just like to pick up right where we left off here with the topic of afterlife and how that relates to the fatherhood of God and so forth. This is important, but I think that you shouldn't put the cart before the horse. Before I look too much at the importance of the afterlife, I really have to consider, well, why mortality anyways? And I don't see mortality as a real obstacle to experiencing eternity. My own experience is that the more I've lived with faith each day of my life, the less and less belief I have, because the more and more experience I have with God and with the brotherhood of man. Mortality is a wonderful opportunity to get in touch with love. There's really a lot to kind of put on the line with the mortal experience. You can only be mortal once, in a sense, if you maintain a conscious identity in the next life, which I believe you do, and that's a part of the plan. So I would just want to reflect that this is a wonderful opportunity to know how real our love is because of our willingness to be faithful without first knowing.
Bill, how about you?
I think I've just about said all I needed to say, but I just say that just want to continue with the struggle, with the challenge, and continue with the journey.
Thank you. Nidra.
Well, hopefully we can all use our words to glorify God and activities to serve Him with devotion, and with our mind to always be thinking of Him and of all people in this world and how we can share God consciousness with them.
Well, we've got about 2 minutes left, Hal. You got anything you want to squeak in here under the wire?
Squeak in under the wire. Only to reiterate, perhaps for those listeners who just tuned in, you know, it is a topic of the fatherhood of God, and I would just want to reiterate that the personal, parental, and free will volition of God is what I consider to be the most helpful to me in my relationship with God. I feel I am a person and I have free will, and I think whatever God is certainly at least that, you know, certainly not any less than my own sense of personhood and free will. And I really delight in it, in being able to cooperate in choosing God as God has chosen me. And I think that that's why the Father word is so important to me, because of the way that fathers must choose on this planet to be parent to children, as mothers don't get that aspect of choice because of biology. And mothers know their mothers, fathers will choose.
Well,
and
you're
we
right.
Can choose.
I had to learn about being a father. I'm actually the father of 3 sons. And I have to admit, from the very moment of their birth, I've been aware that it teaches me about that relationship to the Father. And I want to thank everybody for being here today. It
thank
was
you.
A very stimulating discussion. Thanks, Nidra,
thank
for
you.
Being here. And Bill, good to see you again.
Thank you.
And Hal, I really enjoyed having you here. Thanks for tuning in to Spiritual Spectrum. We hope you'll join us again sometime.